George Blaha, and this is the From Glory Days show, which chronicles the lives of professional Detroit athletes following their pro sports careers. Watch the stories unfold as former Detroit Pistons, Tigers, Red Wings, and Lions share their personal stories of struggle and success as they have transitioned from the pinnacle of their pro sports careers back into normal everyday lives. You won't find another show like the From Glory Days show capturing this transition as told directly by the athletes themselves.
Hi, I'm Jeff Ivory, the financial pro featured on the PBS series From Glory Days. Keep an eye out for my financial tip during today's show, and feel free to visit my website for more information and tips on staying financially fit.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help? Hello, I'm Kurt David, author of the best-selling book, From Glory Days, and your host of the show. Today's guest was a member of the 1968 World Champion Detroit Tigers. He began his broadcasting career in 1993 and is the color commentator of the Detroit Tigers radio network. Let's give a nice warm welcome to our guest, Jim Price.
Thank you very much, Kurt. Thank you.
Jim, you have a life that a lot of great things with baseball, but a lot of great things after baseball, and we certainly want to talk about those as well. But let's back up to talk about those playing days. And what were some of the best memories you have about playing baseball, about being involved, the decision to play baseball?
Well, I had a decision because I was more of a football player from Pennsylvania. Of course, you have to play football back there. And I was recruited by a lot of different colleges to play football, and I chose, because I wanted to get married, chose baseball. And my dad also kind of felt that maybe I wouldn't have as many injuries, even though you saw me limp in. It's a little bit different story, but I chose baseball, and I played in a wonderful era. I played when baseball was a game, so to speak, that people like to talk about. It was kind of old school, and there were different rules. There were different kind of things that you did on and off the field that you don't do nowadays. The game's a lot different. I think the players of today are bigger, stronger. I'm not saying they play the game as well as some of the teams did in my era as far as fundamentals, but I think they're bigger and better and stronger.
Yeah, just the strength and speed alone has increased,
right,
no question about it. You mentioned about the football, and certainly you had some big names after you at that time, you know, that
were
looking for you.
Well, I did.
Coaches.
Well, Duffy Daugherty had me out here at Michigan State, and Frank Cush, who used to coach at Michigan State, had me at Arizona, a bunch of other schools. But a quick story, Joe Paterno was quarterback coach when I graduated from high school back in Pennsylvania. And he came to see me a couple different times. He said, "You're going to be our guy," and all that kind of stuff. Engel was the head coach at that time, but Joe had been there, I guess, so he started in the early 60s. And he said, "You got to come to us," and so forth. So I decided to take baseball, and I took my two older boys back to visit him maybe 15, 18 years ago. I walked in. He said, "I'm still mad at you because you picked baseball." I said, "Gee, Joe, I'm sorry, you know."
Yeah.
But, yeah, Joe.
Worked out a little bit better for me at this point.
Exactly, so. Yes.
Yeah, and so baseball, and you talk about playing during that era. What were some of the special memories you have about that time? I mean, obviously the World Championship, the World Series Championship. But, you guys grew up together. That's one of the things that I hear often about that era is the players grew up together through the minors.
I kid Al Kaline because he never had an opportunity to play in the minor leagues.
Mm-hmm.
And I did play in the bus leagues. I played in the Northern League. I played in where it was snowing in June. We played in Grand Forks, North Dakota. There was snow up there in Winnipeg. We'd play in Winnipeg and Minot, North Dakota. It was something. Then the next year I played in the Carolina League where it was 100 degrees every day. And you really never had off days, but the camaraderie was great. When I was minor league player of the year in 1963 in Kinston, Gene Michael became a manager and big league player and the number one guy for George Steinbrenner's general manager, was sent down from AAA. He was about 8 years older than me, and they sent him down because he couldn't hit. He was going to be a pitcher. So it was a lower minor league team from AAA. He came down. He was our starting pitcher, our shortstop, and our bus driver at the same time. And it was pretty cool. And, it's things like that where you ride the buses, you talk. You know, you'd leave a ballpark and they'd throw some hot dogs on the bus, and that's what you got to eat after the ball game.
You grew up together, yeah.
We grew up together. And you know, when you're young and dumb, seriously, and I mean that the right way, you don't know any better. And it didn't bother you at all. And 2 years I played winter ball. I played winter ball in Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico to try to get to the big leagues that much quicker. But It's interesting, the things you learn. You leave your scrapbook at home, mm-hmm. because everybody's great players. I mean, they're all all-stars, they're all the all-state and all that kind of stuff. So you, if you can't take the ribbing and the kidding you played, and you know mm-hmm. what it's like, we ran guys out of pro ball. They couldn't take the kidding and all that kind of stuff. You have to have thick skin, and besides being a pretty good athlete.
Yeah, so thick skin you had, and it brought you up to the major leagues, as a matter of fact. Right. 1967 was your debut right. with the Detroit Tigers, as a matter of fact.
Well, another story, minor league player. I was number one minor league player in all the minor leagues. Pittsburgh Pirates kept saying, you're going to be our catcher and all that stuff. And I'm in spring training, and I hit like 600 in spring training in Fort Myers. They were going to send me down to Columbus. I said, look, I don't want to go back to AAA again. There's nothing else I can do down there. So Joe Brown, the general manager, pulled me off the bus as we were going to head to the airport. And he said, we just traded you to Detroit. He said, they've been trying to get you for a couple years, and we're finally going to let you go. So I came to Detroit, and first fellow I saw was Mickey Stanley in the locker room, who greeted me. We played against each other. We had some fights in the minor leagues coming up, and Willie Horton. Thank goodness I didn't fight Willie. But and Gates Brown, who I played against in Puerto Rico. So it was kind of neat. Came over to Detroit. And it was a home for me starting in 1967.
Yeah, some great names you played with from that team. I mean, Freehan. And
Billy was my idol, Bill Freehan. I just had so much respect for him. And I used to kid him all the time because I'm blessed I have a lot of hair. And Billy's hair, even in those days, he had the comb over. Mm-hmm. And in Tiger Stadium, in the old locker room, we had these posts with mirrors on them. And Billy would be doing the comb over, and I'd be going behind him. What do I do with all this hair? It would drive him crazy, you know. But great respect for Billy. I try to talk to him on the air, about him on the air as much as I can, because he's a terrific guy.
Did he decide to line up the catching lineup? The guy with hair, the guy without hair?
He was something else, and he was tough as nails, and just one of the all-time greats.
Yeah, that's great. Well, let's talk about that great time, that 68 Tiger, special time in Detroit at that time as well.
Yes.
What are some of your best memories of 1968?
Well, you really go back to 67. We lost the pennant in the last game of the season mm-hmm. when Dick McAuliffe hit into his only double play, hit into all year to end the season. And I got in the locker room after the game, and I'm a young kid, and there's Al Kaline, and some guys have been around a while, and Norm Cash and Earl Wilson, people like that, Mickey Lolich, and, you know, I'm this skinny kid, and I'm looking at these guys, and they have tears in their eyes. Well, that really hit me. And we communicated in the offseason. I lived in Pennsylvania at that time. Went back home. We talked with everybody in the offseason. We went to spring training knowing we should have won, and we were the best team. And we got to spring training. We knew that we were going to wipe out everybody. And it was kind of the feeling that what happened in 67 carried us on through 68. And 68, you might remember, read in a book, we lost the first game, then won like 9 in a row. And it was we really never trailed. And Dick Trzewski, who was one of our utility players, he always said about us, you know, he said, this team was the most out-of-control, great baseball team I've ever been with. Because he was with the Dodgers in 2 World Championships also.
What's he mean by that?
Well, it means that we had a lot of fun together off mm-hmm. the field. We stuck together, a little bit different, you know, in those days. We did a lot of things together off the field, away from the ballpark.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so obviously the great time and the World Series, and like you said, starting off the season with a loss, tough series there in the World Series as well to start off.
Well, we did start, you know, and Bob, the great Bob Gibson was great.
Mm-hmm.
I remember trying to take batting practice before the game, all the media and all that stuff, and the Cardinals were ranked as the best team in baseball, and they were pretty cocky, and I kid them when I see them to this day, I go like this, you guys remember, you didn't get this ring. But they were pretty cocky, you know, they had a great team, they had the highest payroll in sport at that time. And I'm going to say it was like a total of $600,000.
Right.
Counting
for the whole
Bob
team.
Gibson. No,
right.
The starting lineup, counting Bob Gibson.
Mm-hmm.
And he set us down, struck out 17, I think, that first game. But the great Mickey Loggia came through, and we hit the heck out of the ball, came back to win it. It was a great thing, I think, for the for our area. And, of course, great, great memories of that season.
What's that mean to you, that championship? What does that mean to you?
I feel I'm very honored. I'm very honored. Every place I go, people say, boy, thanks for 68. I got to know so many guys that were in Vietnam, and we communicated. We got letters from them, right back to them. They said things like, you got me through the war. You helped get me through the war and so forth. You guys doing what you did. It meant so much to us, and I'm just taken back because I'm in the public eye with my job and with my foundation. And every place I go, people are so wonderful. And the best move I ever made was decided to move here when I decided to move to Michigan to stay here.
Oh, that's great. And, yeah. And you had a great time with the series, at, you know, the championship. Like you said, it was a special time because of the vets and what was going on with the vets as well.
Right.
And also in the city of Detroit, you know, right before that, there was a hard time. And it, it, people say it brought the city back together. It helped bring the city back
together. No question about it. And, you know, with the riots in 67, and you just saw people hugging, and everybody was the same. And we always felt like we were the working person's team. You know, we were down to earth. We were out in the community. We weren't, you know, we didn't have Rolls Royces and things like that. I'm envious. They do now. I'm envious. Yeah. Let me put it that way. But we drove Chevys and things like that, and we were part of the community. It was a great thing, and it's a great thing for me to still to be part of the community.
And after 68, there was still baseball for you. There was still
kept
life
playing,
after
that. Kept playing, but, you know, we really thought we should have won it a couple years in a row. We thought the team was that good, but Baltimore came on. They were a little bit better. But we really thought we should have won it maybe at least two times, and we didn't. We were, you know, unhappy about that, but, you know, it was great playing with those guys, with K-Line and so many great players. Mickey Lolich is one of the best arms I've ever seen. Tough to catch. He was nasty. And, you know, Dick McCullough, hard-nosed guys. Mickey Stanley, hard-nosed. Willie Horton. And you just didn't want to mess with those guys. Willie Horton used to always say, you want me to play the Tigers? You want to have a one-run game, we'll beat you. You want to have a slugfest, we'll beat you. You want to fight, you're in trouble.
Who was the toughest guy to catch for in a team?
Mickey Lolich, because he was he probably – people ask me today, what, because we didn't have radar guns in those days, I'd say he probably threw 94 to 97. And he had movement. He had a lot of movement. He was nasty. He threw a heavy ball. And in those days, you know, there was always payback because pitchers batted. And if one of their guys hit one of – if a pitcher hit one of our guys, Mickey couldn't wait to get out there and hit their guy. It was just a different
era. It was almost expected at that
time. Oh, he couldn't wait. In fact, there was volunteers. Let me do it. No, let me do it. You know, it was great. You know, and Mickey, I love to talk about Mickey because I think he should be in the Hall of Fame. No question.
At what point did you know that Jim Price, or did you start thinking that Jim Price, that baseball was going to be over as a player for you?
Well, I think because I had a backup free hand. In those days, we didn't have free agency. And there were teams that wanted me, but Jim Campbell, the general manager, kept saying, hey, we have the two best catching catchers in baseball. I need you here. I'm not going to let you go to anybody. So I got frustrated, and I was 29, and I just said, you know what, I'm done. I'm not going to play anymore because I had very good offers in industry with jobs because I think at that time I was player rep, and I did some interviews, and I could actually talk and make a little bit of sense, and I think people maybe saw some communication skills that
some
I had.
Potential for you after
baseball.
Yeah,
and I had some good offers, and really, I told you the story earlier, first year out of baseball, I guarantee I made more money than anybody in our ball club. Because it was a different paying era in those days.
Yeah, in fact, I was going to ask, you know, professional athletes take like a 90, 95% pay cut when they're done playing nowadays. And many of them go bankrupt and have financial problems as a result of that adjustment.
Right.
What were some of your biggest financial challenges, if any? There wasn't any, it sounds like, as far as coming out of baseball.
Well, I prepared myself. I did a lot of reading. I studied a lot. I'm a big reader. Always did read. I believe in that to this day. And I really prepared myself. And 2 years before I got out of the game, I used to go over to Olympia Arena and talk with Gordie Howe on an old video, an old recorder, just to practice doing interviews. This was when I was still playing and just thinking maybe someday. Then I went back to Pennsylvania the 1 year and worked in a little radio station, not as big as this room, and pulled off AP and UPI information. And I did a sports like 2 a.m, 6 a.m, and 8 a.m. And try to prepare myself for those opportunities.
Oh, that's great. Well, we have to take a break now for our educational minute. But when we come back, more about Jim Price and his transition from baseball.
As a rule, if you don't fully understand something, you shouldn't invest in it. The financial services industry spends billions of dollars marketing new and crazy ideas every year. If you chase the latest hot trend and buy what everyone is recommending, you're almost assuring yourself of poor returns. Keep in mind that if thousands of highly paid professionals spend their entire lives studying the market and they can't beat it, neither can you. My advice for you is simple. Take a long-term approach to your strategy. Focus your investing in areas with a long track record of success and write your strategy out so that you can refer back to it to rebalance your investments at least once a year. Now that's a formula for long-term success.
I'm Kurt David, and we're back with Jim Price. Jim, when we left off before the break, we were talking about that transition at life after pro baseball, and you actually said that you were making more money after pro baseball than you were from playing baseball.
Well, it was easy in those days because we didn't make much money. You know, I say our average pay for that in those years was probably $35,000, $40,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a different era. You know, you could actually save money. I think the highest salary K-Line got was $100,000. Some of the guys are maybe maybe the big guys making 60,000, but most of them are making 30, 40,000.
Mm-hmm.
And I prepared myself, as we talked earlier, because I knew baseball would not last, especially with there was no free agency. They had a reserve clause where when you signed with the team, you were there forever. So there's nothing I could do about it.
Mm-hmm.
So I got a little, I got frustrated and said, hey, I can do better with my life. And that's why I quit when I was 29. And I could have probably hung on, maybe and gone someplace else, I don't know. But I just figured, you know what, I'm going out and better myself. And I did. Went out and made a lot, financially, a lot more secure.
Mm-hmm.
Took an opportunity with a company, and it worked out great. And then started to do ESPN work. I probably did the first live telecast on ESPN. It was a pro softball game in Kentucky. Oh, I can't even remember. It was their first year. It was mm-hmm. unbelievable. I did ESPN work, and then I did work at Channel 2. And then at the same time, you know, working in the automotive industry.
So you're still doing the sales, you're doing the manufacturing
Well,
rep,
it was great.
And doing broadcasting.
Yeah, I had an opportunity. I'm a member at Oakland Hills Country Club. The only reason I'm a member there when I quit the Tigers, an opportunity to make, as I said, financially a lot more better situation, tremendous expense account, and any country club of my choice. So I took that particular opportunity, and I'm a lifetime member at Oakland Hills Country Club now, and it's worked out very well for me because I really think, and you know, talking of kids watch the show, I think I did prepare myself for later when I was done with my playing career. Even
you knew at some point you were going to be done. I mean, it was
no
only
question
temporary.
About
there's
going
to be a new phase of your life, so to speak.
No question about it. And again, I think I owe a lot of it to reading. I read a lot of books. I still read books. And guys kid me now that I have an iPad 2 with my Kindle on it. They don't see the books I read, but I would be reading maybe a big book and didn't have pictures in it. Guys walk by and say, Jim, where's the pictures? I said, well, I actually read books without pictures, guys. I know it's hard to believe.
Well, I didn't plan on asking you, but since you brought it up, Jim Price, all-time favorite book.
All-time favorite book? Boy, that's a tough one. You know, I just read a great book by Bill O'Reilly about Killing Lincoln.
Hmm.
And I'll put that right up at the list. I think for kids, it's a great historic book. I learned a lot because I am a historian. I love the military. My dad was in the military. I lived in Europe and different army bases around the country. And I love our military, and I read a lot on history. I watch the History Channel at home most of the time, the military channel. And but I know history, and I would put that right up there. And I read the about George Washington. I love to read about our founders. I put those up my favorite books.
Oh, good. I hope you enjoy my book as well. And from
well,
Glory
I
Days
will.
About historic
yes.
names.
Yes, yeah, I love that. Yes, some guys in there I know.
Yeah, yeah. And so when did the shift from the sales rep and to the broadcasting, full time broadcasting? How did that change go for you?
Well, something happened at ESPN where some people saw me. I had opportunities to go to Chicago to do the White Sox and so forth. But recessed just a little bit. I had got to know Mike Ilitch. In the late 60s when I was playing, when he used to bring pizzas down for us to eat in the locker room, maybe we'd talk about Little Caesar. At that time, he only had one or two stores. Got to know him, and he always said, you know, someday, Jimmy, you and I are going to work together. Yeah, Mike, oh, you got it, baby. That'd be great. But I got to know Mike, and I stayed friends with the Ilitch family and the kids, and I always knew that Mike was going to get the team. I really knew that. We used to talk about it. He had a great an assistant by the name of Gary Vito, who's no longer with us, one of the greatest guys in the world. And we were best buddies. We used to talk about Mike getting the team. Then he bought the Red Wings, you know, and so forth. And I had an opportunity to go to some other big league places, but I said, I'm going to wait for Mike. And Mike said to me, you know, Jimmy, you're going to be my guy. And it's been great, you know, going
sure
on my
enough.
20th year. So
yeah, it's worked out.
Yeah.
So the broadcasting, what are some of the highlights of your life? I mean, you're kind of staying in baseball still. I mean, that's a bonus, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it's great. It beats working for a living, I got to tell you. Ernie Harwell, the great Ernie Harwell, I was his last on-air broadcast partner. I heard Ernie Harwell broadcast games for Baltimore when I lived in Hershey, Pennsylvania, which is like 65 miles from Baltimore. Then when I played with the Tigers, he broadcast my games. Then I was his last on-air broadcast partner. And that's my biggest thrill in broadcasting, working with Ernie. And I was kidding Kurt earlier. Ernie would say, you have two first names, Kurt David. We used to talk about that on the air. We'd mention the player, two first names, but I found Kurt has three first names.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
But that's one of my great thrills, working with Ernie.
Yeah, and then broadcasting obviously took off for you as far as on TV, but then became radio.
Yeah, it became radio. Mr. Ilitch, bless him, he loves, and Ernie always said, baseball's radio. And at that time when I was doing PASS, and I was also director of community relations with the ball club, so I'd be at the ballpark 9 o'clock in the morning, do the television at night, get home about, who knows, midnight, and then back right downtown again to do my community relations work with the ball club. And it was quite a grind, but a great experience. And we took over in 92. And it just went from there. And, you know, things were just kept getting better and better.
Speaking of better and better, you keep doing great things in our community and that just, you know, beyond baseball as well. What are some of the other things you're involved with?
Well, I always felt you have to give back. You know, I've never said no to a kid. I would never do that. I remember one time I was leaving a little leaguer. My little league coach picked me up to get an autograph from Whitey Ford in their team bus, and he knocked my autograph book out of my hand. I never forgot it. And anytime I see anybody that would want my autograph, I'm thrilled to death. Believe me, I know who I am and what I'm happy in my skin. I feel very comfortable, but I'm thrilled when people ask that, and I would never say no. And I just think it's the greatest thing in the world.
And so, community is very important.
Community is important. You always did charitable work, and then I have three boys. My youngest son, I'm very proud of all my boys, but my youngest son, Jackson, is impacted with autism. So he's 16 years old, and he's the light of our lives. And we've decided, my wife and I, who's great, Lisa, that we should do something to help other people, because we're in a situation where we were okay. You know, we could do things for our son, but it's very expensive. We felt if we formed a foundation called Jack's Place for Autism that we could help everybody, and we really have. We're 8 years old, and we are well. We're known all around the country for the work we do, and we're trying to build a building now, a life skills building, for kids with autism where they can learn the typical life skills.
No, that's great, and obviously that's one of your passions now, in addition to baseball.
It is a passion. You have to have a passion to be successful. My wife and I are very, very passionate about this.
No, that's a great thing to be passionate about. Well, this is one of my favorite times of the show. We're actually going to take some live studio audience question and answer.
Okay.
And so, well, let's take those.
All right.
Hi, Jim. I'm Dennis from Troy, and I was wondering, after playing the game for so long, was it tough to just go into broadcasting right after that? And by the way, I think you're doing a great job doing the radio broadcast.
I really appreciate that very much. Great to have you here. No, it really wasn't tough because I did prepare myself. I know I talked about that, but I think I knew what I was. I knew the type of player I was. I knew the situation I was in. So I made sure I was ready. If I was playing today, you'd have to tear that uniform off of me, though, because the money you make.
Yeah, it'd be a lot different.
That's right.
Well, let's take another question.
All right.
Hi, my name is Keegan Kenrick. I'm from Farmington Hills.
Nice area. I should have said that, too. I would say that, yeah.
Mr. Price, I was wondering, what was your favorite memory from the 68 World Series?
Well, actually winning the World Series that year, but I came through with a couple pinch hits to win ball games. I hit a pinch hit home run in extra innings to win a ball game at Tiger Stadium when there's, those days, 55,000 people at the ballpark. I mean, it was something. And I remember all the fans going crazy. And actually, when you get a walk-off hit like that, you run around the bases. You don't remember running the bases. You're so thrilled. So that was really one of the great moments for me.
Yeah.
Against the White Sox, too. We hated those guys.
Well, let's take one more question.
All right, this is great.
Hello, sir. How are you? My question is, my name is Caroline Androkovich, and I'm from Troy, by the way.
Nice area, too. Yes.
Thank you. What missing pieces did the Tigers need to address this offseason to win a World Series?
Well, we need a fifth starter, number one. We need a better bullpen to get to the deep part of the bullpen. And I think we're probably looking for an infielder. You know, the strength of any championship team is up the middle. Alex Avila is an all-star catcher. Austin Jackson, an all-star defensive center fielder, and hopefully he'll get better offensively. But I think we need to be better, a little bit stronger right up the middle, second and short. So I would think with the winter meetings, will be coming up, that there'll be, I have a feeling they might be looking in those areas. But we got to get some bullpen help, too.
Yeah, great. Well, Jim, this show is about the transition of professional athletes after pro sports, but we want it to be more than that. In other words, what advice would you have for anybody that's facing transition, not just an athlete, but anybody that's facing transition or change or adversity? What advice would you have?
Well, I think the mental part of life is very difficult. Mental part of sports difficult, but in everyday life is to do. I think you have to stay upbeat, and you have to be prepared, and just don't go out there and say, hey, somebody do something for me. You have to help yourself. And to help yourself, you have to be prepared, whether it's getting all the information you can get on wherever you want to go or what you want to do, but you have to prepare yourself mentally for the move.
So a positive attitude.
No question.
Take you far.
That's what it's all about.
Yeah.
When you walk on stage, you got to have a smile on your face.
Well, we're positive. This has been a great show, and we're happy to have you on here. I'm Kurt David, and this wraps up another show. I'd like to thank our guest, Jim Price, for joining us. Please join us next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from glory days. That's it, Jim.
Good job, Kurt. That's fine.
Hi again. I'm Jeff Ivory, and I hope you enjoyed today's show and the educational minute I shared with you. If you'd like more information on staying financially fit through your life's transitions, please visit my website at jwifinancial.com.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help?